Any chance I could get more volume on that?
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Is that okay?
Perfect.
Right.
Okay, and then let's do... volume. Can I have more volume on this one? So this is more than the other one then? It needs more than the other one?
Okay. Might be easiest to set it all the way up here, and then you can adjust it there.
Go
Does
down.
That work?
Okay. And then I have... Woo! Okay. So I can change that. Okay. Oops. Too loud. Okay. But I can make it go down here, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
Okay. I'm sorry I may blast you guys, and then I'll adjust as quickly as I can. Okay. I'll also adjust that down. Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe we should
okay.
adjust the whole thing down just a little bit. Do you guys? Right. Yeah, because it's just maybe too much.
You want to try that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Welcome, everybody. My pleasure to introduce Lamaira this evening. And I will do a complete introduction, including all of her artistic achievements as well as her scholarly achievements. Welcome. okay, I have a very long list, but this is extremely... I asked for the long resume, so I'm very pleased to have this information. She's been first dancer with Carlota Santana, Flamenco, Vivo, Fred Darso Dance, and Passion y Arte, performing throughout North America in venues such as Carnegie Hall, the Kennedy Center, and Jacob's Pillow. Mayra has been featured in several documentaries and has been awarded choreography grants from Pew Charitable Trusts, the American Dance Festival, and the New York State Council on the Arts. She choreographed Carmen under the baton of Seiji Ozawa and under the direction of Nick Mooney, the first staging of the 1915 version of Manuel de Falla's Amor Brujo. So you can see really interesting artistic credits. Passing on to her scholarly credentials, she holds an MFA in choreography and performance, and an EDD in dance history from Temple University. An EDD under the mentorship of Brenda Dixon Gottschild, and I'm very pleased she's here this evening. The dissertation was called Border Trespasses, the Gypsy Mask, and Carmen Amaya's Flamenco Dance. She has curated 100 years of flamenco in New York at the New York Public Library for the Performing Arts, and co-authored the exhibition catalog. She co-edited Flamenco on the Global Stage, Historical, Critical, and Theoretical Perspectives, 2015. She co-organized Spaniards, Indians, Africans, and Gypsies, the Global Reach of the Fandango in Music, Song, and Dance. Bilingual conference proceedings are published, and all English proceedings from Cambridge Scholars Publishing. A co-edited anthology also, stemming from another meeting, Spaniards, Natives, Africans, and Gypsies, is entitled Transatlantic Malagueñas and Zapateados in Music, Song, and Dance. So you can see what is building to be a very substantial publication record. She is planning a third conference in the Fandango series as well. Actually, she recently had one in Veracruz, Mexico, and there's yet another to be held in
Africa.
In Africa, so this is a movable this is a movable feast. In October 2018, Mayra co-organized a conference and performance festival, The Body Questions, mm-hmm. celebrating flamenco's tangled roots at the Fashion Institute of Technology and CUNY Graduate Center, and she's currently preparing an anthology stemming from these events. She's writing with Peter Manuel and Michelle Hefner-Hayes a book, Flamenco, History, Performance, and Culture, Cambridge University Press forthcoming, and is working on a new monograph, Arrow of Song, Sounding Time in Flamenco Rhythm, Gesture, and Voice. She teaches at Fashion Institute of Technology as a resident scholar at the Foundation for Iberian Music at the CUNY Graduate Center. And last but certainly the major point is her book just recently out, Sonidos Negros on the Blackness of Flamenco, Oxford University Press, 2019. Okay. Welcome, La Mayra.
Thank you so much for coming. I want to thank Mark and Karen and the Temple Dance Department. It's really an honor to be back here at my alma mater. What do you think of that? I fell in love with flamenco when I was 15 years old, and I still am in love with flamenco. My path into academia has not been conventional. I was a performing artist long before I entered the world of scholarly endeavor. After I finished my doctorate at Temple in 1995, I took a 15-year hiatus to perform, teach, and raise my kids. But when my hair started going gray and I reached the age my mother was when she died, I realized that there was something else I needed to do. As I waded through a morass of disparate sources, fighting to weave wisps and suggestions and fleeting perceptions into a cogent and meaningful set of arguments, I was often sustained quite simply by the sense of obligation to tell the story that my quirky path in life has opened before me. My first monograph, Sonidos Negros, is what I'm very proud to talk to you about today. When I first came back to the US from 5 years dancing in Madrid in 1985, I stayed on a friend's couch in Philadelphia. I'd really only performed in Spain, so I didn't have any dancing gigs at first. And I sold encyclopedias, remarkably unsuccessfully, door to door. And then I worked as a waitress in a Fitch restaurant. And finally, in desperation, I auditioned for the Temple graduate program. And that was a life-changing stroke of luck, because I met and quickly bonded with Brenda Dixon Gottschild, who had become my dissertation advisor, my mentor, and my friend, and who has given me the incredible gift of writing the foreword to the book, to Sonidos. So Mark counseled me to use my work to give you as emerging scholars some useful insight, and here it is, as Brenda told me long ago, write from the body and write with purpose. Brenda was writing Digging the Africanist Presence when she was guiding me in writing my dissertation on Carmen Amaya, and that's what I thought Sonidos was going to be about, digging flamenco's Africanist presence. But as I entered the work, that's not what unfolded before me. The singer in this clip is Francisca Méndez Garrido, La Paquera de Jerez. The people accompanying her are all her family and neighbors, all Andalusian Roma, or so-called gypsies. They are from Jerez de la Frontera, an agricultural community known for sherry, near the Atlantic port of Cádiz. The artists in this clip are descended from a small number of flamenco families who poet García Lorca said were the keepers of the flamenco cantejondo, or deep song. These families are linked by long-standing social and professional networks along the trade routes of the millennial capitals of Andalusia, Cádiz, Sevilla, Córdoba, and Granada, and the many towns in between, especially along the basin of the Guadalquivir River, which connects many of these cities. 2 weeks ago, Lila Aisha Jones explored the sacred and life-affirming and also hegemon-busting and subversive aspects of breathing together. We in flamenco do that too, as you see here in the way everyone says ole at the very same time. When I was in high school, a friend took me to watch a flamenco class. Whoops. Oh, sorry. The maestra, tiny and pretty, with a piquant face, was teaching sitting in a chair because she had a cast on her leg. She raised her arms in the way that great flamenco dancers do, with purpose, humor, ferocity, and majesty, all at the same time. She was absolutely intimate and personal, and yet also detached. I began to weep. As soon as I graduated college, I traveled to Spain. I landed in Madrid on a Monday in 1980, before most of you were born, full of excitement and planning to study flamenco for a year. On Tuesday, I went to class with the brilliant dancer who had been my teacher in California, Carmen Mora. On Wednesday, upon her recommendation, I auditioned for a job dancing in Los Cabales, a tablao or a flamenco club on the Plaza Mayor, which catered primarily to groups of Japanese tourists. That Friday, much to my astonishment, my flamenco career began. Of course, I had no idea what I was doing, but I was smart enough to realize that and to be in wonder at the gift that I had been given. I was undocumented and worked 7 days a week for half the salary of documented workers on a week-to-week contract at Los Cabales until after 18 months and with great relish, I quit and took a better job at a different tablao. I spent 5 years performing nightly in flamenco clubs alongside a list of artists that take the breath away from flamenco aficionados, Arturo Pavón, Antonio Canales, Manolo Soler, Diego Carrasco, Tony El Pelao, El Indio Gitano, Ramón El Portugués, Guadiana, Enrique El Soto, El Camborio, La Rebomba de Málaga, and goes on. And these experiences remain my deepest flamenco education and point of reference. The thing that was so unique about working in tablao, which are sort of like jazz clubs, was learning to improvise. Flamenco performance is a commercialized spectacle, but its language is that of communal ritual. I remember one of my early performances at Los Cabales. I performed the ending steps of a dance and I stopped with a flourish, but the musicians kept playing. I circled around and tried it again with the same result. Finally, I turned to the musicians, which you are not supposed to do, and I begged them to please release me. I learned that day that the communication in flamenco doesn't happen in the external form of the gesture, but rather in the intention with which it is performed. And that was an essential lesson. This is Carmen Amaya, 1939, Cuba. Flamenco unfolds in a space of perfect rhythm. It is a luminous space where all sounds fit together in balance and harmony, relaxed and seemingly still, with no nervousness or crowding. It is a space of aliveness, free of anxiety, where the small flowers into an infinite cycle. Each beat falls directly toward its absolute center, and the slightest wobble is disturbing. This is the stage for the singing voice, the most important, and I might even say sacred element in flamenco, to play out its journey. Each flamenco song, while improvisationally interpreted and assembled freely of verses from the traditional songbook, has an arc like an arrow's flight. It begins with the singer warming up, as we heard Paqueta do. This is the quejillo, the complaint, or the wail. From there, the song builds to a macho, the height in both pitch and emotional tone, and finally to the song's often common or ironic landing. Within the communal rhythm, absolutely stable and encompassing in motion, the singer growls and shrieks, sighs and moans, slides into notes from intensely off-kilter angles, and sends other aloft into soft arcs, punches and stretches, lifts and drops and vibrates words with what many have called wildness, but which, even if we choose a less racially loaded word, should fairly be described as abandon. The freedom of the flamenco voice to submit to such a vertiginous letting go depends on the stability and motion of the rhythmic bass. In my experience, dancing also sounds its own expressive freedom through a play of equilibrium, which is why I put that Carmen Amaya video on for you. Stepping into the sonic flow of clapping hands, guitar, and voice feels to me as though my center of balance is oscillating within my body against the surface of my skin. I feel like I am resonating in the spaces between the beats, so much so that after I returned to the United States and performed for the first time solo in Carnegie Hall, the vast and unbound expanse of the audience before me and the weirdly mediated sound system of the musicians behind me made me literally feel that I had no balance. I had no surface on which to project my center. And so when I wrote my doctoral dissertation on the great Carmen Amaya, the first Roma performer to become an international star in the 1940s, this experience helped me understand what made Amaya's dance so powerful to international audiences. It was precisely her risky play with balance, scaling up and thus making visible one of flamenco's central kinesthetic and aesthetic tenets. I will talk more about this risky play of weight in flamenco dance, which I feel is analogous to the singing voice, in just a minute. Like West African griots, the flamenco singers assemble their songs out of an inherited body of knowledge and oral tradition. Some flamenco verses can be traced to the light operas of the 19th century, such as Mariano Soriano Fuertes' El Tío Caniditas, Uncle Caniditas of 1849. This was the moment when flamenco was first recorded as a genre of performance. 1849 was a year of increasing strife in the United States. Frederick Douglass would give his speech, "What to the Slave is the 4th of July," just 3 years later. But blackface minstrels touring Europe in the 1840s established performance tropes that soon became ubiquitous and trendy representations of the ascendant Americas. U.S. blackface minstrelsy, like the institution of slavery itself, was a peculiar reflection of Romanticism's deeply perverse fascination with the human victims of colonial enterprise. But 19th century Spain, in free fall from the pinnacle of white hegemony, was itself seen, as in Washington Irving's Tales of the Alhambra of 1832, as the voluptuous, Moorish, read African, object of colonial predation. This is the painting by Francisco de Goya. It's titled The 3rd of May, 1808. Spanish guerrilla fighters had captured the European imagination with their fierce resistance to Napoleon's invasion of 1808 to 1814. But Napoleon's invasion had devastating effects on the Spanish Empire. Taking advantage of the turmoil, Bolivia, Mexico, Venezuela, Chile, Argentina, Uruguay, Peru, Ecuador, Panama, Guatemala, El Salvador, Costa Rica, and Honduras all progressed with successful revolutions for independence during the years 1809 to 1825. By 1898, Spain would lose its last remaining Caribbean and Pacific possessions, the islands of the Philippines, Puerto Rico, Guam, and Cuba, in the Spanish-American War. By the 19th century, Spain's great empire, upon which the sun never set, was rotting like a tree into the forest floor. This was exactly the moment and historical context in which flamenco was born, and therefore we cannot extricate Spain's ambivalent absorption of and complicated responses to U.S. blackface minstrelsy in flamenco's formation. 19th century Spain's dreams of sovereignty and autonomy were paradoxically achieved by performing and eventually becoming, in the eyes of Europe, flamenco. Flamenco means Flemish, but ironically inverts this term. The Spanish Netherlands, held by the crown from 1581 to 1714, were a lucrative and rebellious but troublesome part of the empire. Over the course of the 18th and into the 19th century, Spain, the once feared conqueror and preeminent colonial power, became flamenco, a derisive comment on the patent absurdity of its claim to Europeanness. By the time flamenco emerged as a genre in the mid-19th century, its disordered and raucous universe, the emblematic ole of gypsies, smugglers, fortune tellers, and prostitutes, described a long demarcated and, I argue, racialized zone within Spanish performance. Flamenco's essential qualities, its tumultuous sensuality, quixotic idealism, and fierce soulfulness, thus echo with the socio-political and aesthetic contests that trace the rise and fall of an empire. The Spain of El Cid, the champion in the war against the Muslims, and of Hernán Cortés, who conquered the Aztecs, was reduced to performing itself for tourists. Soriano Fuerte's 1849 El Tío Canillitas is a romantic comedy of mistaken identity set in the Spanish South, Andalusia. It features an English tourist in Gitano drag. But it parodies not the English, but rather the tourist vision of the nation as Gitano other. It is thus a deeply ironic self-portrait, which references more than anything Spain's long and excruciating decline. If, as I will presently describe, Spain's Muslim and Jewish past had become racialized, the Moor became black. Spain itself, by the 19th century, was seen as black in the eyes of Europe. As Alexander Dumas is famously reported to have said, Africa begins at the Pyrenees. The Estrecho, the Straits of Gibraltar, that separate Spain from Africa is only 9 miles wide. And all of the countries that you see on this map were once part of an Islamic cultural sphere that dwarfed Europe. As one brief example, one of the Afro-Muslim dynasties ruling medieval Iberia, the Almohads, built a tower, the Kutubiya, in their African capital of Marrakesh in 1158. That's the one on the left. And a sister tower, the Giralda, in their Iberian capital, Sevilla, in 1172. For centuries, the Giralda was the tallest tower in Europe. During the 11th and 12th century Almohad period, we see the development of what art historian Cynthia Robinson calls a multi-confessional and intertextual plurality of Jewish, Muslim, and Christian mystical lyric traditions, to which I wonder whether, as we discussed yesterday, we should not add also animistic African mystical practices circulating northward. The language of mystical love, of love that pierces you like Cupid's arrow, and to whose possession you must submit to with complete devotion, was influential not only in the elaborations of the notions of courtly love, but also of Christian religious dogma, such as the Passion, in which Jesus' submission to death was seen as the salvation of humankind. Yet in a fascinating process of what Eric Lott calls love and theft, as Christian dogma wove the strands of Muslim and Jewish mysticism into its iconography of spiritual devotion as whiteness, it simultaneously began to denigrate or blacken those very Jewish, Muslim, and I will argue in my next book project, animist notions of transcendent and orgasmic yielding to the divine. By 1492, once Catholicism gained control of the peninsula, of the Americas, and of the narrative, blackness was universally cast as lasciviousness. Muslims, so-called Moors, became black, which is to say that their gifts to Western civilization were to be absorbed into the hegemonic lexicon while they, as humans, were cast out. This song, and you can hear that, I want to be in America rhythm, right? This song was written, this is the best teaching tool ever invented. This song was written by Alfonso X, the Castilian king whose father, Fernando III, had captured Sevilla in 1248, reducing Muslim-ruled Iberia to only the Kingdom of Granada. But it is written in the bilingual rhythmic and verse structures that are unique to Muslim Iberia. So think of jingle bells, as we talked about yesterday. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. That rhyming pattern, verse form, comes from medieval Iberia, from the medieval Iberian context. And these bilingual and multicultural sung poems of Islamic Iberia propagated via troubadours and court musicians throughout neighboring European courts. Catholicism had not yet conquered the peninsula, and the three Abrahamic religions lived together uneasily, but the products of Iberian culture, from musical instruments such as the lute to innovative uses of rhyme, to 12th and 13th century translations of Aristotle, Averroes, and Maimonides, from Greek, Arabic, and Hebrew into Latin, were enormously influential in the European Renaissance. As medievalist Maria Rosa Menocal argues, the indebtedness of the Christian West to Spanish Islam and the anachronistic belief that the civilization of Spain did not constitute an integral part of Europe stems from an inherently racist view that the real culture of Western Europe is unadulteratedly Latin Christian, Hellenic in its ultimate ancestry. Further, the deep non- and pre-Islamic African cultural inheritance that impacts Europe via Spain remains almost completely unexplored. Flamenco and the Andalusian communities in which it originates thus grows not only out of the transatlantic intercultural circulations driven by colonization and slavery, but also out of its 800-year lineage as part of the Afro-Islamic world, which included not only what we tend to think of as North or White Africa, somehow separate and distinct from the rest of the continent, but really all of Africa north of the Guinea coast and the Eastern Horn, as well as what is now the Middle East, Damascus to Jerusalem to Mecca and Medina, and of course east of that as well. Early modern Spain and its vast empire in the Americas was governed by the certification of limpieza de sangre, purity of blood. Raza, or race, a term which comes from animal husbandry, from breeding pure white sheep, signified first and foremost the invisible stain of non-Christian lineage. Long before the Catholic kings Ferdinand of Aragon and Isabel of Castilla established the tribunal of the Holy Office of the Inquisition in 1478 and expelled Jews and Muslims in 1492, the same year that they funded Christopher Columbus's world-shattering landing on Hispaniola, now DR in Haiti, European ideas about nobility as established by bloodline had begun to thicken into codes establishing access to power on the basis of religious distinction. Apocalyptic fears of contagion, as Jews were blamed for the Black Plague that swept mid-14th century Europe, killing more than a quarter of Europe's population in less than two decades, were magnified by dogmatic interpretations of original sin as a heritable stain and the crucifixion of Jesus Christ as proving that Jews are a deicide nation. The massacre spurred by the arrival of plague in Barcelona in 1348 was followed in 1391 by another paroxysm of bloody attacks on Jewish communities across what is now Spain. Adopting Christianity was the only way to avoid slaughter, and by the early decades of the 15th century, as much as half of the Iberian Jewish population had converted to Catholicism. Conversos, Jewish converts, now acquired a new social and legal status. They were new as opposed to old, referring to those of pure blood, Christians. Moriscos, who are Iberian Muslims who had converted to Christianity, were also classified as new Christians. Conversion supposedly solved the intractable problem of Jews as, James Carroll writes, the original and quintessential dissenters, calling into question the supremacist universalism of faith, of claims made for Jesus Christ. But, Carroll continues, new Christians posed formidable problems, stirring paranoia about conversos as duplicitous bloodsuckers, parasites feeding on the host society. Educated, wealthy, and skilled Muslims and Jews had been integrated at the highest levels of late Reconquest Iberian society. Jewish moneylenders funded the Reconquest, Jewish physicians attended at Christian and Muslim Iberian courts, and Muslim troubadours circulated as far as Sicily and France. Such professionalism stirred class resentment and violence against new Christians. Thus, beginning with a decree issued in Toledo in 1449, religious difference inherited in the blood, racialized religious difference, became a legal doctrine. The 1449 decree declared that the faith of Jews who had converted to Christianity was suspect, and therefore Jews should not hold public offices from which they might injure or insult pure old Christians, lindos cristianos viejos. This doctrine codified what conversion to Christianity, along with the forced adoption of Christian Moors, had made invisible, the indelible stain of impure or non-Christian lineage, raza, or race. Old Christians were lindos, pretty, a term related etymologically to limpieza, cleanliness or purity, as in limpieza de sangre, and also to the Latin limpidus, clean or clear, impeccable, spotless, flawless. The 1449 decree racialized Judaism, making it a matter of blood that could not be expunged by conversion. In so doing, Spain linked raza, or impurity of blood, to diminished social status. Under Isabel and Fernando, who would unify what is now Spain under their rule in 1492, cultural cleansing was prosecuted by the Inquisition. New Christians suspected of secretly practicing Judaism were savagely punished with autos da fe, public rituals of torture and humiliation that culminated in burning victims alive. Carroll remarks that Spanish Renaissance painter El Greco, and this painting is from 1610 approximately, used a palette of death to visualize a religious imaginary marked by sadistic concentration on physical torment as a source of salvation. The aesthetic of death, the Catholic veneration of death and martyrdom, horribly and perversely funds the violence upon which our society is built. In Sonidos, I examine how flamenco dances out the aporetic, and that is not operatic, but aporetic, as in holding the contradiction within it, of what we now think of as race. Racial or racist ideology originated in Catholic battles against Judaism and Islam on the Iberian Peninsula, on the cusp of the world-shattering European conquest of the Americas, as the casting of religious difference onto the surface of the skin. Christian universalism, justified the barbarities of the transatlantic slave trade, but paradoxically also undermined racial categories. Enslavement and forced conversion to Christianity were claimed as a boon to their victims, yet to deny any human beings the possibility of redemption from their abject state was to deny Christ himself. To understand how foundational Spanish racial thinking is to current ideologies of race, consider that the brand used to mark enslaved people, often on their faces, was the word esclavo, symbolized as an S and a clavo in this manner. Spain sowed our ideas of race as an inexpugnable stain and immolated such impurities along with its own history at the stake of the Inquisition. And yet, the violent pressure to suppress religious dissent engendered a society racked by skepticism and confounded by the ironies of false identity. Sonidos Negros describes how these instabilities and internal contradictions are reflected in flamenco's ironic and equivocal performances of blackness as bulla, or confusion. Spain's fraught racialized history remains inscribed upon the dancing body. The systematic erasure of any traces of Jewish and Muslim cultures continued during the reign of Isabel and Fernando's son, Carlos V, who banned Muslim cultural practices in 1526. Carlos V's son, Felipe II, proclaimed stringent new laws in 1566 and ordered censuses tracking genealogy, compiling massive information on Spain's population. The Spanish crown thus bureaucratized ethnic difference, managing the population on the basis of detailed and substantive information it collected on its subjects. Felipe II's successor, Felipe III, completed the project, ordering the expulsion in 1609 of the Moriscos, those former people of Muslim lineage who had converted to Christianity. But the state mandated that Moriscos leave behind all their children under the age of 5, and in most circumstances, below the age of 10. Such cruelty merely amped up the pressure to assimilate, to learn to speak in Christian, that is, in Spanish, to abandon their traditional dress, to intermarry with old Christian families in order to blend in or slip back into Spain. The very implementation of these policies sowed destabilizing seeds of doubt. We see in this image of Felipe III, commissioned in commemoration of the decision to expel Muslim-descended Christians, that the king represents himself as a Christ-like good shepherd. In the field tending his flock, he has seen the star and heard the voice of the angel, and having understood that Christ is born, has rushed to worship him at the manger. He depicts himself in this image as the humble steward of an idealized Spain, cleansed of cultural and biological traces of Moorish and Jewish Iberia. This shepherd trope is, of course, central to Christian iconography, but this trope goes to the crux of the acute instabilities that would eventually topple Spain's empire. On the one hand, social hierarchy was determined by blood purity, a system in which one drop of bastard lineage could disinherit. On the other hand, the imperialist agenda of colonization was implemented through evangelization, whose rationale depends on the idea that Christian redemption is possible. Spain bound these contradictions together by conceptualizing invisible impurities of the blood as materialized on the surface of the skin in the form of physical defects represented in dance, as a counter-hegemonic denial of upright virtue and harmony in favor of lascivious confusion. This conceptualization of race as embodied leads directly to the aporetic, again not aporadic, performances of the Pastor Bobo, the bumpkin shepherd. In Christmas pageants across the Spanish Empire, the Pastor Bobo comes bumbling onto the stage, ostentatiously eating pork and drinking wine as an affirmation of his purity of blood. But he's startled and incredulous at the appearance of the angel. Will he see the light of Christ or won't he? Teetering between confusion and epiphany, hell and heaven, the Bobo struggles to comprehend Catholic doctrine, his tragicomic antics providing both comic and entertainment and recapitulation of the canonical message. In order to emerge from his perilous yet comic confusion, the Bobo must recognize that Christ is born. His idol, danced with clumsy steps and noisy footwork, figures his unredeemed state. His progress toward epiphany, or lack thereof, is correspondingly enacted through transformations in and elevation of his deviant speech from pidgin to Latin and from ostentatiously muddled body language to virtuosic composure. Notions of racial difference thus constructed the rituals of Christmas. The Pastor Bobo's confusion and ruckus danced in terms of unbridled gambols and noisy footwork were codes for being of dubious and therefore suspect lineage. The Bobo's clowning enacted the central story of evangelization, epiphany, the acceptance of Christianity leads to redemption and the supposed proffer of citizenship. But at the same time, the transformation that epiphany wrought in this character's body language dramatized the caste distinctions that stratified Spanish society and the circular logic of whiteness as moral virtue. The unbridled ruckus of the Bobo's stomps and gambols was distilled in aristocratic Spanish dance academies into virtuosic jumps as marks of distinction, refinement, and training, depictions of the Bobo who had shaken off his confusion, certified blood purity, citizenship, and social status. Virtuosic representations of the Bobo thus paradoxically enacted religious, political, and racial legitimacy. Within a generation of the expulsion of the Moriscos in 1609, and this image actually comes from 1602 from Negri, in aristocratic dance academies in Spain, virtuosic jumps such as the boleo, so the boleo is a jump where you're standing on one foot, you kick the other leg up into the air, then you jump off of the supporting leg and beat it against the leg that's in the air, rotate your body 360 degrees, and kick a tassel that's two handspans above your head, and then land back on that supporting leg. That's a boleo. Try to do it. The boleo is the danced equivalent to Felipe III's pictorial statement, asserting that aristocrats were humble shepherds who had been redeemed and were thus epitomes of Christian virtue. These virtuosic jumps, I argue, feed into the character dancers of the 18th century ballet, and the narrative of the Pastor Bobo's redemption, I argue, echoes not only in the aspirational harlequins of early colonial United States, but also in the most infamous character of U.S. blackface minstrelsy, Jump Jim Crow. But the Bobo's representation of confusion often became less a bridge to redemption than an expressive end in itself, opening a space for enacting the most profound imperatives of resistance to slavery and genocide. Cloaked in bulla, in comic confusion, performances of the Bobo, and this is a performance at a Christmas celebration in Cuba in 1855, preserve the cultures and religions of home in mighty syncretism, defying and denying abjection and asserting the ancestral lineages of those enslaved. The Bobo's antics thus enact equivocal devilry, but also the pathos of diasporic sadness and terrifying violence. Those who do not accept Christ are doomed to exile, bondage, and extirpation. Jumping in dance, thus I argue, leaves this gravely consequential racial and racist distinction between Jump Jim Crow and the virtuosity of courtly ballet hanging in the air. And in flamenco, jumping turns out to have a fascinating and only recently discovered racialized aspect. In 2015, when I met my dear friend Kiko Mora for the first time, I showed him a film made by Lumiere at the 1900 Paris World's Fair. which I knew to be important because it was the first film of a flamenco cuadro. That's a performing ensemble of guitar, dance, singing, and clapping percussion. My friend Kiko had worked on the 1894 film by Thomas Edison of Spanish dancer Carmen Dulce Moreno, La Carmencita, and I had worked on the 1917 films made by Leonid Massin in preparation for Treecorn of the illustrious flamenco dancer Juana Vargas La Macarrona. So we decided to write an article together about this 1900 film, and Kiko set about identifying the artists. Previous studies of this film had identified the male dancer as Maestro José Otero Aranda. But as we began the process, Kiko insisted that it could not be Otero dancing. The dancer was a black man, he asserted. I resisted, partly because in all my years of Spain, I had never seen a black flamenco dancer. Only after Mora documented that Otero was not in Paris when the film was shot, but Jacinto Padilla and Negro Meri, a celebrated mulatto, unremembered in the flamenco community and by all but a handful of flamenco historians, was I able to look at the film and see clearly that Kiko was right. The first male flamenco dancer ever filmed was a black man. Which begs the question, how could we not have seen this in the first place? Meri was born in Algeciras, my guess would be around 1850, and therefore, although he was black and we think of Cuban descent, and of course Cuba did not abolish slavery until 1886, having been born in Spain, he was probably a free man. He was a polymath, a bullfighter, a producer, a well-known flamenco singer and dancer. He was the first to perform flamenco in Córdoba in 1873. And he was also an equestrian acrobat, we think, from a circus family. In the 1840s, a grotesque clown, and here I think the term grotesque is used in the sense of the Italian grotesco or the French comique dancer, which is to say an athletic jumping clown, with the same nickname, Meri, performed the extraordinary and dangerous double somersault with two complete revolutions in the air at the Madrid Circus. My hypothesis, based on the flamenco custom of passing nicknames along within artistic lineages, is that this Señor Meri was Padilla's father. Meri was known for his dangerous Salto de la Batalla, in which he somersaulted over various circus lads holding up rifles with bayonets, and he was also known in the bull ring to sit in a chair in the middle of the ring and wait for the bull to be almost upon him before jumping out of his chair to stab the bull with his banderillas or lances. Is this the jump that Meri employs in getting up out of the chair in this 1900 film? By the way, all of that is in complete perfect rhythm, just FYI. Mm-hmm. And I have the slow motion. I had never seen anybody do this before or since. He actually does two more jumps. The form he's doing is Bulerias, flamenco people. Mm-hmm. And he lands that with this bullfighting gesture. In fact, I think that this unremembered flamenco artist has not only left his stamp on flamenco singing, but on flamenco dance as well. Witness the signature jumps of Antonio Montoya Flores, El Farruco, one of the greatest male flamenco dancers of the 20th century, whose children and grandchildren have developed his style to ever greater athletic heights. Oh. And you see the play of weight. You can see that he's a god for us. And I will also say, I have the slow motion here. He is from Triana, which is the neighborhood where there was a lot of intermingling between Roma, Afro-Iberians, Moriscos, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Wow. Try to do that. Early modern Spain had a substantial black population, as evidenced by the Hermandad de los Negritos, the Black Brotherhood, founded in Sevilla in 1393. By the mid-15th century, the Portuguese seafaring incursions into West Africa kidnapped increasing numbers of people and transported them to Sevilla and later Cadiz to be sold into slavery. During the 15th and 16th centuries, enslaved African and Afro-Iberian people made up 10% or more of these cities' populations. But as the transatlantic slave trade ramped up, kidnapped Africans were transported directly to the Americas, and Spain's black population declined. Jews and Muslims had been expelled in 1492, Moriscos, Christians of Muslim descent, in 1609, and by the 18th century, Afro-Spaniards, too, had largely disappeared from the population. Of course, we know that they're still there. Now, the Spanish Roma, host for these vanquished others, became the embodiment of Spain's imaginary of blackness. Of course, the Roma had never been considered even remotely Spanish until 1783, when Carlos III rescinded the genocidal policy of detention and forced labor for those whom we call gitanos. Nonetheless, by the time flamenco emerged as a form of performance in the mid-19th century, the stage gitano was paradoxically an assertion of Spanish national identity, of castizismo, or whiteness. The figure of the gitano, haunted by the others whose wealth and culture had been sucked into the coffers of the church and crown, paradoxically represented the liberal democratic values of freedom and autonomy, that is, of membership despite the declining fortunes of the nation as a whole in the economic and political structures of colonial power. As in the United States, this vessel for the soul of the nation, voicing sorrow and loss, precariousness and nostalgia for past glory, was the embodiment of blackness, a parody of self as other, of power as powerlessness. For Spain, the stage gitano represents what Saidia Hartman terms the metaphorical aptitude of blackness as an imaginative surface upon which the master and nation came to understand themselves.
Excuse me. That last image, what were we looking at?
Oh, I'm sorry. I should say. So this is the Brotherhood of the Negritos that was founded in 1393. The Ku Klux Klan got it from Spain and not the other way around. Yeah, I know it's disturbing. I should have said something. Yeah, that's what they wear and what the penitents wear in Holy Week. They Yeah. And I don't know why that is. I do not know why that is, but it definitely is.
It points toward God.
Oh, is that what it is? Yeah. But why did the Ku Klux Klan take it? Maybe
it was weird looking, mysterious.
And covered the face.
And covered the face, exactly.
The claiming of the exotic as self enacts a fantasy of wealth and domination, fulsome in its ironic self-awareness and its disillusioned sense of its own diminution, a national identity imbued with self-conscious irony, laughing derisively at its own mirror image. And yet, in this solipsistic reflection of radical incongruence, we sense also flamenco's tragic essence, its loss and its pain, its tormenting spirit, its duende. If Goya's Majos depict the dewy pastoralist fantasies of dissolute aristocrats, his brutal Saturn devouring his son of 1819 to 1823 depicts, in the words of art historian Robert Hughes, the torment of lust for power in a society so reactionary that tradition justifies an unthinkable incest where fathers eat the young and the future is murdered. Like the victims of the public autos da fe, publicly enduring torture and a degrading death, there is something of the sacred and the sublime in flamenco's expression of suffering, a morality of resistance. This is Farruca, by the way, the daughter of that great dancer we just saw. One of the earliest documented entries of the Roma into Spain is on January 12, 1425. The immigrants claimed to be penitents from Lower Egypt, that is, from Africa, and said that they had been exiled from their home as just punishment for having temporarily turned against Christianity, the true faith. This dissembling claim, playing on their dark looks and positioning themselves precisely in the hiatus between Muslim and Christian worlds, is the source of the word gypsy or gitano in Spanish, and also the English word gyp and the Spanish gitanada or swindle. Across the diaspora, traditional Roma occupations such as metalworking, animal husbandry, and performance have been handed down in repertories adapted from generation to generation. And as John from Egypt Minor did in 1425, Spanish Roma have often exploited the negative or ambivalent image which outsiders may have of them, employing the multi-signifying practices of dissemblance that performance theorist Jana Brown ascribes to performers who play in the field of racialized fantasies. In his 1613 novella, La Gitanilla, Cervantes describes Roma street performance as blending singing and dancing with fortune telling, first drawing the cross on the fortune singer's palm in either gold or silver. You should know the title character brazenly claims, ignoring her abject social status in addressing a noble woman, that making the sign of the cross on the palm of the hand with a copper coin damages the fortune. The threat implicit in this performance of difference is, of course, the bad luck potentially conjured by the same magic that allows the fortune teller to look into her client's future. George Borrow, an English Bible salesman whose book, The Sincali, documents 5 years spent among the Spanish Roma in the 1830s, tells of another performance practice, the drow, which was poison that the gitanos would fling into the cattle mangers. Sometimes the Roma would pick up the discarded dead animal to eat, but sometimes they would only make the animal sick, and then they would offer their magical services to the owner. The purpose of using these claims, writes Borrow, was to foster the idea already prevalent that they were people possessed of supernatural gifts and powers. But Spanish Roma did not inspire quite the same horror that Jews and Muslims did. Instead, like Native Americans and Africans, Roma were seen as a subject nation, slave labor meant to be exploited by the empire. Spanish Roma were thus widely denied the status of raza and were instead seen as a criminal and polyglot class of thieves and bandits, outlaws and beggars. For the Spanish crown and for the Inquisition, the problem with the Roma was that they resisted. As we have seen in the impertinence of Cervantes's Gitanilla, the Roma deny abjection, claiming to have, as Carmen Amaya once famously sang, the blood of kings in the palm of their hand. And one thing the Roma did to raise suspicion, many scholars think, was to admit Moriscos and African Iberians into their families, thereby impossibly confusing the question of who is and who is not racially Roma. The problem of identity raised by the Roma refusal to comport with the racist system is fundamental, that people may not be who they seem to be. The Roma scrambled the definitions of race as embodied religious difference. Recall Spain's fraught attempts to reconcile Christian piety, which embraces Gentile and Jew equally, since to deny this precept would be to deny Christ himself, with the doctrine of Judaism and Islam as inexpugnable sins of the blood. Spain's crucial conceptual move was to cast this invisible blackness of the blood onto the surface of the body and into the performances of noisy confusion and suggestive sensuality. Flamenco's performances of blackness thus materialized the hideousness of racialized difference at the heart of Spain's national identity. In Sonidos, I trace the doublings and redoublings of ironic self-awareness and disillusionment that situate flamenco within Spain's aporetic, not operatic, identity. Spain wielded its racist codes regarding religious differences as weapons of conquest of the so-called New World. And, as in the example of the dollar sign, I think it's important to bring to light the extent to which white supremacy today is branded by 15th century Christian universalism. In Sonidos, I identify bulla, or confusion, as a place of pain and marginalization, but also of refuge and resistance, a place where, while seeming to comport with hegemonic religious and aesthetic codes, Spain could perform being who it is not. Consider the multiple lines of gaze traced in Velázquez's iconic Las Meninas of 1623, or the dilemmas of identity, who is original and who is a double. Did anybody see us? Figured so acutely in Miguel de Unamuno's play El Otro, which translates as The Other, of 1926. Flamenco represents Spain's troubled attempts to reclaim its lost stature among European nations, its whiteness, by embodying its blackness, thus scrambling the very notion of race, which founded the empire as a stable category. This instability, introduced by the Christian notion of redemption, cracks just slightly the carapace of racial ideology, an aperture through which flow, I argue, subversive and indeed transformative bodily forces. Flamenco's instantiation of modernist becoming happens within black subjectivity. Last slide, promise. Flamenco's power to, in the words of poet Federico García Lorca, evade the riddle of metaphor and gulp down reality like a carnivorous flower, rests in the self-consciously subversive performance of its own negative image. As Carmen Amaya said of the story of her family setting fire to a chest of drawers in order to grill sardines at the Waldorf Astoria in 1941, quote, "But son, how were we to eat sardines grilled on the floor like savages? At least we would have grilled them on a stuffed cushion," end quote. The Spanish Roma perform not being who they seem to be, the crux of Spain's problematic conceptualizations of race, with exquisite sensitivity. Flamenco seemingly performs racialized identity, yet it contains its antithesis, signifying racial instability instead. Roma unruly disdain vibrates with the alienation and distance that for performance theorist and poet Fred Moten represent the critical possibility of freedom. The Spanish Roma assert a modern and self-consciously ironic subjectivity with arrogant brilliance. Stuart Hall has theorized diaspora as a radical homelessness, an expression of an ethics of the self attuned to the edges. Flamencos, whose embodied and minstrelized blackness is figured by the Spanish Roma, have always known this statelessness, have always adhered to this code. The gitana, forced to view herself as if through the eyes of other, is not only the object of gaze, but with intimidating acuity, she also gazes back. And to paraphrase Frantz Fanon, it is her body which questions. Thank you.
First, made a. Can people hear me without the mic?
It's for the live stream.
Oh, okay. So, Maida, first of all, a comment first and then a question.
Okay.
All right. My comment is I've read the book twice.
Oh, wow.
It's completely brilliant. You know,
me ve con buenos ojos. He's my friend and student from a long time.
And you know, for the last 50 years, I've been reading everything I could lay my hands on about flamenco. And this is, without question, the most cogent, intense, and powerful book on flamenco I have ever read.
Oh, thank you.
anybody here that has not read it yet, you need to go on Amazon and get it immediately. so that's my comment. I would have expected nothing less. You have always been this brilliant star in flamenco.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, and you set me on a road toward hopefully some small afición that I'm hopefully getting to eventually. But at any rate, that's my comment. My question is this. My second reading of the book, I thought to myself, oh my God, I had to go back and look to see when it was published. It was published this year.
Right.
I'm wondering whether there is any, whether you have any thoughts about the resurgence of racial horror in this country, and whether this book is in fact a timely response to all of that, that I think should, if I wish there was a Nobel Prize for flamenco literature, because I believe this deserves it.
There definitely should be one for me, at least.
Well, no. But truly, it is the most timely book, yeah. One of those timely books I've read, about what we are experiencing here now and what has been our legacy yeah. of racism in this country.
Yeah.
And I was blown away by it.
Thank you, John. I mean, we were having this conversation earlier about how there is a, like in the last 5 years, I would say, there is this development of a field of Roma studies, which didn't exist 5 years ago. And, you know, kind of one of the things that I think is really productive about talking about Roma culture and sensibility is that they really are a stateless people. And so they do help us understand, in some ways, what it is to be living in diaspora. And as you say, I mean, this is obviously something that is just a phenomenon that is growing and growing and growing right now. And it sort of makes sense for us all to be thinking about that. You know, what is identity, you know, as distinct from nation? Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I look forward to reading the book. I was very intrigued and inspired by your sort of working through this physical metaphor, the corporeal instability,
uh-huh.
and the sort of instability of racial categories that the Roma perform. And I'm wondering what comes of that, or... is it always unstable? Is there a resolution? Is there a falling over? Is there a regaining balance? I'm resisting wanting like a closure, but in terms of the physical metaphor, how do you oscillate eternally?
Well, I mean, I guess I think there may be there. Thank you so much for saying that, because I was going to take it out because I thought it was like too weird and wordy. But yeah, actually, you know what, when I did my dissertation here a long time ago, that was what I concluded about Carmen Amaya, was that, you know, the way she embodied Roma aesthetics was by this play of balance and play of weight. And so yes, it does resolve. It does resolve. But the whole game of flamenco, so this is, I guess I talked to you guys yesterday about, I've been studying Afro-Caribbean percussion for about 4 years now. I'm a baby, but it's really fun. And, you know, what I talk with my teacher about a lot is this, the cycle that there is in, like, the clave, for example, that always has to have a beginning and then an end. It always has to cycle. It always has to be a complete cycle. But flamenco improvisation is different from that. And even though my teacher and I both agree that flamenco is definitely an Africanist form, definitely we agree with that, but the improvisation or the structure of improvisation is about catching a ball and then throwing it into the air for yourself. How many times? As many times as you want. And then when you're finally done playing around with that moment, you grab it, which is what Paqueta does at the end of that song, and you throw it onto the next person. That becomes their turn, right? So it's a game. And you know, I guess the other thing I would say is that, you know, in dance terms, that instability only is possible in that circle. It's only possible in the rhythmic circle, because that's what holds you, right? It's like these lines of energy, right? It's like lines of resonance, perhaps you might say, right? So literally what I learned that day in Carnegie Hall was that when you're on a stage, you can't dance like that. You have to hold your center in a different way. And it, you know, it was a really interesting revelation for me, you know. And the reason Carmen Amaya was able to do that, and I was thinking about Argentina, for example. If you see those early dancers before Carmen Amaya, they have so much, she has so much, I mean, I'm very old, so I can't do it anymore, but she has so much power, you know, of grabbing the floor, like, up and down, and the reason she was able to do those falls is because she has that much strength, and that's very different. That's a very different approach, dance-wise, to the people that had preceded her. And in fact, when she came to New York in 1941, I interviewed one person who had been there before, and she said Carmen Amaya came and they all of a sudden saw her making rhythm with her hands, like this incredible, incredible rhythm that she would make. Nobody had ever seen that before, and they would go into the studio and like try to learn how to do that rhythm. Now everybody does that rhythm. But at that time it wasn't, you know, part of what people had seen. So, you know, there's a lot, the instability depends on the stability, and, you know, kind of sociologically, if you will, you know, their position is always outcast, and, you know, that's how they like it, I would say, you know, that's what their culture is. But it's always this this bosom of family is all I can, the only way I can think of to say it, you know. It's, there is something very stable, even if it's mobile, right?
Thank you so much, Myra. I'm thinking of what the terms are really of this aporia. Not opera, but aporia. And I'm thinking indigeneity and nomadism, thinking of Pratika's work too, because, right, because they are nomads. They're coming from Egypt, as you said, but they are also occupying a position of indigeneity.
Right.
As in a kind of, in this very self-contradictory way that you describe, which is basically also a bulla, you know, it's
a burlesque.
Very Baroque.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, it's been conceptualized to some degree as a Baroque, but I'm wondering about this instability we're talking about, indigeneity and nomadism, belonging but moving
right.
on, or belonging in a place but not I don't think those two terms are considered generally as synonyms, but I think maybe here in this contradictory structure, they perhaps are. I was wondering if you had any thoughts on that.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you who I took out of the presentation, and now all my Flamenco friends are going to now turn on me right now. Okay. I took out Rosalía, who is a pop star. And she performed at Coachella, you know, she's like gotten Grammys and stuff like that. And
front page story in the New York Times.
The front page story. I took a slide out of that. and, you know, to me, she represents this kind of global neoliberal mediascape thing where, you know, and I've seen YouTube videos that Spanish people have put up on the internet saying, you know, oh man, you know, like I'm here in, you know, Alicante and I can go on the internet and I can see all of this culture and I can take it and use it in my own way. And for me, as an older person and as a traditionalist, I would say, in my orientation, I find her to be like fingernails on the chalkboard because I feel like she's minstrelizing from the Spanish side, so she's minstrelizing the Roma image, and she's also minstrelizing the African-American image in a way that I don't think Spain understands. It's icky. And what it has to do with is this kind of stateless world that we live in, where anybody feels like they have access to anything. And, you know, yes, art belongs to everybody and art is of the whole world, but there's something about, you know, giving credit to your sources or, on, you know, going back to the community and, like, going back into conversation with the community instead of, like, making money and, you know, leaving town and doing another thing, you know, taking on another mask. Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure if I'm addressing your question, but that's the thought that comes to mind, because the nomadism and the indigeneity can be appropriated, I suppose, is the word I wanted to say. Yeah, you know, somehow.
Yeah, but I'm not
thinking
about that so much as I'm thinking about actually this impossible self-contradiction that you're describing in the instability.
Mm-hmm.
That something there.
Right.
It's not about commercialization.
So I mean, I feel like the instability within the Roma dancing body, let's just say, you know, that nomadism, that kind of bouncing this way. It is within the container, right? It is within that cultural container or that physical container or that spatial sonic container. And that is an ethical, I think that's an ethical stance. And we have to continue the conversation, I think, right?
My name is Robert Kenyatta.
Hi.
And I'm a percussionist for the last 70-some years.
Oh, wow.
My question was that you mentioned the hand clapping that she did. Would you say that was influenced, number one, from the intermingling of the culture, African culture? And my interest is, was it a sort of clave that they play like in Puerto Rico and Cuba?
Uh-huh. So... okay, I'm going to try not to betray my teacher here. Certainly in Flamenco, there are kind of waves of Africanisms that come into Flamenco. So Flamenco was part of the African cultural sphere for almost 1,000 years. And then I would say in 1492, like, those people don't just magically go away. And in fact, what happens is that they, you know, a lot of people that were carried over to the Americas created musics that then filtered back, and, you know, it just cycles around again and again, I would say. And some people talk about how, people that were enslaved were prohibited from using their drums because drums can speak and carry messages that would be subversive. And, I would not doubt for a minute that that's the case, but there's also a tradition in Africa, which has got these clapping percussion. So, you know, I mean, I think that there's an interculture there between this percussion and the drum percussion for sure. And the rhythm, so, let me see. That's a 6/8, right? And that fits with ours. Ours is like, dang, 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 for example. So if they fit together for sure, but ours is not, it's not identical. But there are so many, like, I have a lot of conversations that we could have about, like, fives. And, yeah, there are, like, a lot of different, there are a lot of different overlaps for sure, for sure, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. My teacher says that the thing that he thinks is most African, so my teacher always talks about how a drummer's job is to sort of get everybody, all the practitioners into sync and then pull the rug out from under them. And so they go into possession. And when we do, you know, like if we do, ba, ba, how long? And you saw Farruko do that, right? You saw him like, walk, 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 bah! You know, like, it's, he thinks that kind of breaking, that's the most African thing that he notices about flamenco, which I thought was really interesting. Yeah.
One other thing you mentioned, the, as a drummer, I call it the one.
Uh-huh.
And staying on that one, or that rhythm, even though it may consist of more than four or five beats instead of, you know, you have the one here.
Mm-hmm.
It's basically, I mean, I teach the one.
Okay.
You have to be able to hold your one.
Yeah.
Now, a one may consist of more than one beat.
Right.
As long as you hold that beat.
Right.
And then I relate to a drummer or folks that I'm teaching that the one implies right in life. Because whatever you're doing that's correct in life, to me, that's staying on the one.
Yeah.
And don't let anybody else take you off that path on your one. And the dancing starts on the one. And yeah. They stay right there,
yeah.
The clapping and everything.
Yeah, thank you. Totally.
On the one. On the one. I love that. The whole thing about instability, though, and Mayetta, obviously you've referred a lot in the book to Robert Farris Thompson.
Right.
So the whole sense of this instability, which of course is also a part of many, I'm making up a new word, dislanded peoples, okay? Dislanded peoples is a... a function of this, and I wouldn't say just Africanist, but certainly a function of the dislanded worldview, whether it is of the African peoples who became Roma, or the African peoples who went to South America. And again, how it's dealt with is, and that's what's still so beautiful to me about the 10 canons of fine form in Robert Farris
right.
Thompson's African Art in Motion, and the whole idea of talking about art in motion, the idea that all these things happen all the time and that you, whether you are a musician or a dancer or a writer, that you are constantly negotiating the mean.
Indeed.
And in that sense, it becomes very classic in Europeanist ways of negotiating the mean. Sophrosyne in Greek, you know, and Greek culture then being, if you will, a parallel with Yoruba culture or Western African cultures that strive, in a sense, through the imbalance for the mean.
Right. Mm.
Thank you.
I think this is a ponderance that I'm not sure has a question. I always say that. Then I'll come to a question. Well, I guess what I'm trying to coordinate in my thinking is the deployment of the Roma aesthetic on their part. I'm using the Carnegie Hall example of burning the chest of drawers to then grill your sardines, which I love. And so what I'm trying to think about is how they're able to deploy this Roma aesthetic. I'm looking at a parallel in relation to African Americans and the existence of, for example, this might be a long reach, I think, but maybe you can put me back on track, cooning. The idea, C-O-O-N-I-N-G, this idea of performing.
Oh.
Performing.
Geography, right?
The performing geography. Sort of the stereotype.
Right.
For the pleasure of the white viewer.
Right.
For the pleasure of white viewership.
Right.
And I'm thinking about how they're able to negotiate that. I think that it kind of comes back to this kind of cycle. Does the cycle ever end? So that's my ponderance.
Yeah.
How they're able to do that, do what they do, and then the parallel, the idea of cooning becomes our stigma.
Right.
But we don't get to do our whatever you want to call it, the black aesthetic without it then.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's interesting because it's all very. You've made me think of a bunch of different thoughts, and I'll see if I can coordinate my thoughts in relation to what you were saying. But yeah, I feel like on the one hand, you know, what you're rightly touching on is how distressing all of this is and how difficult it is to talk about, and. You know, so with utmost respect for all of you here, like, I just feel like, as you know, from my experience, I'm just trying to like open up that conversation in whatever way it can be productive. And you know, there's no doubt that Roma people can pass more easily than Black people can in Spain. There's no doubt about it. Even though a lot of Roma people, I am positive, are Afro-descended. Like, a lot of Flamenco people are Afro-descended, for sure. Like, Yinka's totally working on that now, I know. But nonetheless, you know, it literally is true that as Spain, as the Americas sucked the economic prosperity away from Spain, people could no longer buy other people. And that is why our, you know, and I'm sure that our Black population became less because of people marrying other people, you know, I mean, people making families. And, you know, we have documentation of that throughout all time. And, you know, a lot of the Flamenco people are called like El Negro, or they're called El Moreno, or they're called El Sambo, which was a word in the Spanish caste. Well, it's like Sambo also, but that also comes from a Spanish word in the caste system. It's one of the castes, you know, it's like an Indian and a Black person marry. That's a Thambo, whatever, you know. So there's this thing about being able to pass, and I would say that the Roma are able to pass in a different way. That's something that's true. And we don't, and you know, Spain, and when I went to Spain, I did a tour of Spain last November. I went to 9 Spanish cities. And we were talking about this yesterday about, like, what was the reaction to this? And, you know, they don't have the experience of slavery. It's like, what I said to them was, it's like we have an open wound in our culture that's just, you know, it's just... They're at a greater distance. They don't see it. They literally don't see race there, even though they're the ones who invented race, you know. So there's that. you know, I think it's, I think the U.S. experience is very different in that way, you know. But the other thing I will say, and I, you know, I've been sort of thinking about this, I've actually, you know, I've been so inspired by Jamila Lawale's work, you know, I'm so inspired by his work. And, you know, there's this thing about kind of telling the story about yourself in a different way and sort of conceiving of yourself in a way that's different than what you know the society's fallacy, you know, false impression of you is. And the Roma are just masters at that. That's what they don't believe it. They just don't believe it, you know. And if you're like in a household, like, they're just going to be like, you know, they just don't believe it. They don't believe it for a minute. So they may do the cooning that you say, you know, they may comply with all the stereotypes, but it's like to take the money and put it in your pocket and go home.
Just a little bit more. It's such an interesting conversation, but this whole thing, this idea of cooning and the sense that, in a sense, I feel like hip hop did that.
Totally.
You know, as an aesthetic, as a form.
Yeah.
From the whole thing of men braiding their hair in what used to be like old fashioned cornrows that someone would hide. It was the male hip hoppers, I think, who brought that first forward, and it was like, oh, I didn't make that a stereotype, you did it, you know. And something that I quoted from Miriam Soto in the Black Dancing Body book, and I can't remember what chapter it is, but I asked her something that she talks about, and I did all this stuff, and I said something about stereotypes. She said, well, why should I let their stereotypes stop me from my pleasure?
Right.
Really? And this line that you quoted of, and I love the side eye she's giving. The thing that she said, the blood of kings in the palm of my hand. There's that line from Kendrick Lamar, the Damn album, where he says, I got loyalty and royalty inside my DNA.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I mean, it's like the places of excitement and ecstasy that are involved in being on the edge that way.
Indeed, indeed. You know? And flamencos look to black culture. Flamencos emulate black culture. Like, flamencos know, they appreciate and they see themselves in black culture, for sure, you know. As,
and the stuff that you had done before about the vaudeville acts.
Right, exactly, through. Exactly.
Nana's work is like all over the place.
My work is unstable.
Yeah. Maybe one last question.
We're late.
Okay, thank you. Maybe sort of a related question to the last comment and musing. And I wondered if you could comment on, I guess, Spain's conflicted relationship with flamenco. So we know about, you know, flamenco being marketed as a tourist, as a big tourism industry, and that flamenco being declared as, you know, UNESCO national or international heritage treasure. But then I guess a year or so ago, there were some Spanish cities that were denying their connection with flamenco. And, you know, Spain is not just flamenco. We are science and we are forward-thinking. And thinking about that, I guess, as an outsider art or as the perpetuation of a stereotype or any number of things, I wondered if you could comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, Spain has a very, very, a very conflicted and conflictual relationship with flamenco, and always has, right? And, you know, a lot of the kind of motors of developing the form have to do with that. Like, you know, I'll do flamenco, but in a more aristocratic way, you know? And then, you know, the people, like the Spanish, in those cafés cantantes that I showed you, that the picture that was the theme picture for the series, they used to have two cuadros. They would have a classical cuadro where they're doing, you know, bolero stuff, and then they would have a flamenco cuadro. And there's this funny anecdote where they actually had a competition, And there was this famous bolero dancer who could like do all these fancy beats and things like that. And then the flamenco dancer like, you know, beat him in the competition. But there's always this kind of like, you know, imitating each other, I would say, and also opposing each other at the same time. And that's kind of what moves the form forward in a lot of ways.
But isn't that part of that contrast in flamenco? You can be the regal, elegant ruler of the stage, and you can also be raw. You have to be in total control.
Right.
You have to throw in there with
indeed. Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Instability. Thank you so much, you guys. Thank you.
Will you sign books?
I will. I mean, of course I will. Are you kidding?
Oh.